This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: John Brown's Body by Stephen Vincent Benet. Invocation. American muse whose strong and diverse heart. So many men have tried to understand, but only made it smaller with their art. Because you are as various as your land, as mountainous deep as flowered with blue rivers, thirsty with deserts buried under snows, as native as the shape of Navajo quivers, and native too as the sea voyage rose, swift runner never captured or subdued, seven-branched elk beside the mountain stream, that half a hundred hunters have pursued, but never matched their bullets with the dream, where the great huntsman failed, I set my sorry, and mortal snare for your immortal quarry. You are the buffalo ghost, the bronco ghost, with dollar silver in your saddle horn, the cowboys riding in from painted post, the Indian arrow in the Indian corn, and you are the clipped velvet of the lawns, where Shropshire grows from Massachusetts sods, the gray main rocks and the war-painted dawns, that break above the garden of the gods, the prairie schooners crawling toward the oar, and the cheap car parked by the station door, where the skyscrapers lift their foggy plumes of stranded smoke out of a stony mouth. You are that high stone and its arrogant fumes, and you are ruined gardens in the south, and bleak New England farms so winter white. Even their roofs look lonely and the deep, the middle grainland where the wind of night is like all blind earth sighing in her sleep. A friend, an enemy, a sacred hag, with two tide oceans in her medicine bag. They tried to fit you with an English song and clip your speech into the English tale. But even from the first, the words went wrong. The catbird pecked away the nightingale. The homesick men begot high cheekbone things, whose wit was whittled with a different sound. And Thames and all the rivers of the kings ran into Mississippi and were drowned. They planted England with a stubborn trust, but the cleft dust was never English dust. Stepchild of every exile from content, and all the disavouched hard-bitten pack, shipped overseas to steal a continent, with neither shirts nor honor to their back. Pimping grandee and rump-faced regicide, apple-cheeked yonkers from a windmill square, Puritans stubborn as the nails of pride, rakes from Versailles and thieves from County Clare, the black-robed priests who broke their hearts in vain to make you god in France or god in Spain. These were your lovers in your buckskin youth, and each one married with a dream so proud he never knew it could not be the truth, and that he coupled with a girl of cloud. And now to see you is more difficult yet, except as an immensity of wheel, made up of wheels oiled with inhuman sweat, and glittering with the heat of ladled steel. All these you are, and each is partly you, and none is false, and none is wholly true. So how to see you as you really are? So how to suck the pure distillate stored essence of essence from the hidden star, and make it pierce like a riposting sword? For as we hunt you down, you must escape, and we pursue a shadow of our own that can be caught in a magician's cape, but has the flatness of a painted stone. Never the running stag, the gullet wing, the pure elixir, the American thing. And yet, at moments when the mind was hot with something fierier than joy or grief, when each known spot was an eternal spot, and every leaf was an immortal leaf, I think that I have seen you, not as one, but clad in diverse semblances and powers, always the same as light falls from the sun, and always different as the differing hours. Yet through each altered garment that you wore, the naked body shaking the heart's core, all day the snow fell on that eastern town, with its soft pelting little endless sigh of infinite flakes that brought the tall sky down, till I could put my hands in the white sky and taste cold scraps of heaven on my tongue, and walk in such a changed and luminous light as gods inhabit when the gods are young. All day it fell, and when the gathered night was a blue shadow cast by a pale glow. I saw you then, snow image, bird of the snow. And I have seen and heard you in the dry, close huddled furnace of the city street, when the parched moon was planted in the sky, and the limp air hung dead against the heat. I saw you rise, red as that rusty plant, dizzied with lights, half mad with senseless sound, enormous metal, shaking to the chant of a trip hammer striking iron ground. Enormous power, ugly to the fool, and beautiful as a well-handled tool. These, and the memory of that windy day, on the bare hills beyond the last barbed wire, when all the orange poppies bloomed one way, as if a breath would blow them into fire. I keep forever, like the sea lion's tusk, the broken sailor brings away to land. But when he touches it, he smells the musk, and the whole sea lies hollow in his hand. So from 100 visions, I make one, and out of darkness build my mocking sun. And should that task seem fruitless in the eyes of those, a different magic sets apart, to see through the ice crystal of the wise, no nation but the nation that is art. Their words are just, but when the birch bark call is shaken with the sound that hunters make, the moose comes plunging through the forest wall. Although the rifle waits beside the lake, art has no nations, but the mortal sky lingers like gold in immortality. This flesh was seeded from no foreign grain, but Pennsylvania and Kentucky wheat, and it has soaked in California rain, and 5 years tempered in New England sleet, to strive at last against an alien proof, and by the changes of an alien moon, to build again that blue American roof, over a half-forgotten battle tune, and call on Shirley from a haunted ground, armies of shadows and the shadow sound. In your long house there is an attic place, full of dead epics and machines that rust, and there occasionally, with casual face, you come a while to stir the sleepy dust, neither in pride not mercy but in vast indifference at so many gifts unsought, the yellowed satins smelling of the past, and all the loot the lucky pirates brought. I only bring a cup of silver air, yet in your casualness receive it there. Receive the dream too haughty for the breast. Receive the words that should have walked as bold as the storm walks along the mountain crest, and are like beggars whining in the cold. The maimed presumption, the unskillful skill, the patchwork colors fading from the first, and all the fire that fretted at the will, with such a barren ecstasy of thirst. Receive them all, and should you choose to touch them, with one slant ray of quick American light, even the dust will have no power to smutch them. Even the worst will glitter in the night. If not, the dry bones littered by the way may still point giants toward their golden prey. The end. Prelude, the slaver. He closed the Bible carefully, putting it down, as if his fingers loved it. Then he turned. Mr. Mate. Yes, sir. The captain's eyes held a shadow. I think while this weather lasts, he said, after a pause, we'd better get them on deck as much as we can. They keep better that way. Besides, he added, unsmiling, she's begun to stink already. You've noticed it. The mate nodded, a boyish nod of half apology. And only a week out too, sir. Yes, said the skipper. His eyes looked into themselves. Well? The trade, he said. The trade's no damn perfume shop. He drummed with his fingers. Seemed to be quiet tonight, he murmured at last. Oh yes, sir, quiet enough. The mate flushed. Not what you'd call quiet at home, but quiet enough. Said the skipper. What about the big fellow? Tar barrel, sir. The man who says he's a king. He was praying to something, it made the others restless. Mr. Olson stopped it. I don't like that, said the skipper. It was only an idol, sir. Oh. A stone or something. Oh. but he's a bad one, sir, a regular sullen one. He eyes in the dark like a cat's, enough to give you. The mate was young. He shivered. The creeps, he said. We've had that kind, said the skipper. His mouth was hard. Then it relaxed. Damn cheating Arabe, he said. I told them I'd take no more of their pennyweight kings. Worth pounds to look at, and then when you get them aboard. Go crazy, so they have to be knocked on the head. Or else just eat up their hearts and die in a week. Taking up room for nothing. The mate hardly heard him, thinking of something else. I'm afraid we'll lose some more of the women, he said. Well, they're a scratch lot, said the skipper. Any sickness? Just the usual, sir. But nothing like plague or... No, sir. The Lord is merciful, said the skipper. His voice was wholly sincere, an old ship's bell. Hung in the steeple of a meeting house. With all New England and the sea's noise in it. Well, you'd better take another look, see, Mr. Mate. The mate felt his lips go dry. Aye, aye, sir, he said. Wetting his lips with his tongue. As he left the cabin. He heard the Bible being opened again. Lantern in hand, he went down to the hold. Each time he went, he had a trick of trying. To shut the pores of his body against the stench. By force of will, by thinking of salt and flowers. But it was always useless. He kept thinking. When I get home, when I get a bath and clean food. When I've gone swimming out beyond the point. In that cold green, so cold it must be pure. Beyond the purity of a dissolved star. When I get my shore clothes on and one of those shirts. Out of the linen closet that smells of lavender. Will my skin smell black even then? Will my skin smell black? The lantern shook in his hand. This was black here. This was black to see and feel and smell and taste. The blackness of black, with one weak lamp to light it. As ineffectually as a firefly in hell. And being so, should be silent. But the hold was never silent. There was always that breathing. Always that thick breathing, always those shivering cries. A few of the slaves. New English, at least the English for water and Jesus. I'm dying. Sick. My name's Caesar. Those who knew. These things said these things now when they saw the lantern. Mechanically, as tamed beasts answer the whip crack. Their voices beat at the light like heavy moths. But most made merely liquid or guttural sounds. Meaningless to the mate, but horribly like. The sounds of palateless men or animals trying. To talk through a human throat. The mate was used. To the confusion of limbs and bodies by now. At first it had made him think of the perturbed. Blind coil of block snakes thawing on a rock. In the bleak sun of spring or judgment day. Just after the first sounding of the trump. When all earth seethes and crumbles with the slow, vast, moldy resurrection of the dead. But he had passed such fancies. He must see. As much as he could. He couldn't see very much. They were too tightly packed, but no plague yet. And all the chains were fast. Then he saw something. The woman was asleep, but her baby was dead. He wondered whether to take it from her now. No, it would only rouse the others. Tomorrow. He turned away with a shiver. His glance fell. On the man who said he had been a king, the man. Called Tarbarrel, the image of black stone. Whose eyes were savage gods. The huge suave muscles. Rippled like stretching cats as he changed posture. Magnificence in chains that yet was ease. The smolder in those eyes. The steady hate. The mate made himself stare till the eyes dropped. Then he turned back to the companionway. His forehead was hot and sweaty. He wiped it off. But then the rough cloth of his sleeve smelt black. The captain shut the Bible as he came in. Well, Mr. Mate? All quiet, sir. The captain looked at him sharply. Sit down, he said in a bark. The mate's knees gave as he sat. It's hot down there. He said a little weakly, wanting to wipe. his face again, but knowing he'd smell that blackness. Again, if he did. Takes you that way sometimes. Said the captain, not unkindly, I remember. Back in the 20s. Something hot and strong. Bit the mate's throat. He coughed. There, said the captain. Putting the cup down. You'll feel better now. You're young for this trade, mister, and that's a fact. The mate coughed and didn't answer, much too glad. To see the captain change back to himself. From something made of steam to want to talk. But after a while, he heard the captain talking. Half to himself. It's a fact that, he was saying. They've even made a song of me, ever heard it? The mate shook his head quickly, oh yes you have. You know how it goes. He cleared his throat and hummed. Captain Ball was a Yankee slaver. Blow, blow, blow the man down. He traded in niggers and loved his savior. Give me some time to blow the man down. The droning shanty filled the narrow cabin. An instant with gray Massachusetts sea. Wave of the north, wave of the melted ice. The hard salt sparkles on the harder rock. The stony islands. Then it died away. Well, said the captain, if that's how it strikes them. They mean it bad, but I don't take it bad. I get my sailing orders from the Lord. He touched the Bible. And it's down there, mister. Down there in black and white, the sons of Ham. Bondservants sweat of their brows. His voice trailed off. Into texts. I tell you, mister, he said fiercely. The pay's good pay, but it's the Lord's work, too. We're spreading the Lord's seed, spreading his seed. His hand made the outflung motion of a sower. And the mate, staring, seemed to hear the slight patter of fallen seeds on fertile ground. Black shining seeds, robbed from a black king's storehouse. Falling and falling on American earth. With light, inexorable patter and fall. To strike, lie silent, quicken. Till the spring came with its weeping rains, and the ground bore a blade, a shadow sapling, a tree of shadow. A black-leaved tree, whose trunk and roots were shadow. A tree shaped like a yoke, growing and growing. Until it blotted all the seamen's stars. Horses of anger trampling, horses of anger. Trampling behind the sky in ominous cadence. Beat of the heavy hooves like metal on metal. Trampling something down. Was it they? Or was it cold wind in the leaves of the shadow tree? That made such grievous music? O Lordy Jesus! Won't you come and find me? They put me in jail, Lord. Way down in the jail. Won't you send me a prophet? Just one of your prophets. Like Moses and Aaron. To get me some bail? I'm feeling poorly. Yes, mighty poorly. I ain't got no strength, Lord. I'm all trampled down. So send me an angel. Just any old angel. To give me a robe, Lord. And give me a crown. O Lordy Jesus. It's a long time coming. It's a long time coming. That jubilee time. We'll wait and we'll pray, Lord. We'll wait and we'll pray, Lord. But it's a long time, Lord. Yes, it's a long time. The dark sobbing ebbed away. The captain was still talking. Yes, he said. And yet we treat 'em well enough. There's no one. From Salem to the Guinea coast can say. They lose as few as I do. He stopped. Well, mister. The mate arose. Good night, sir, and good night. The mate went up on deck. The breeze was fresh. There were the stars steady. He shook himself. Like a dog coming out of water, and felt better. 6 weeks with luck and they'd be back in port. And he could draw his pay and see his girl. Meanwhile, it wasn't his watch, so he could sleep. The captain still below, reading that Bible. Forget it, and the noises still half heard. He'd have to go below to sleep, this time. But after, if the weather held like this, he'd have them sling a hammock up on deck. You couldn't smell the black so much on deck. And so you didn't dream it when you slept. The end. Book 1. Jack Elliot had been out all day alone. Except for his new gun and Ned, the setter. The old wise dog with autumn in his eyes. Who stepped the fallen leaves so delicately? They barely rustled. Elliot trampled them down. Crackling like cast-off skins of fairy snakes. He'd meant to hunt, but he had let the gun rest on his shoulder. It was enough to feel. The cool air of the last of Indian summer. Blowing continually across his cheek. And watch the light distill its water of gold. As the sun dropped. Here was October, here. Was ruddy October, the old harvester. Wrapped like a beggared sachem in a coat. Of tattered tanager and partridge feathers. Scattering jack-o'-lanterns everywhere. To give the field mice pumpkin-colored moons. His red clay pipe had trailed across the land. Staining the trees with colors of the sumac. East, west, south, north, the ceremonial fume. Blue and enchanted as the soul of air. Drifted its incense. Incense of the wild. Incense of earth fulfilled, ready to sleep. The stupefied dark slumber of the bear. All winter, underneath a frozen star. Jack Elliot felt that turning of the year. Stir in his blood like drowsy fiddle music. And knew he was glad to be Connecticut-born. And young enough to find Connecticut winter. Was a black pond to cut with silver skates. And not a scalping knife against the throat. He thought the thoughts of youth, idle and proud. Since I was begotten. My father's grown wise. But he has forgotten. The wind in the skies. I shall not grow wise. Since I have been growing. My uncle's got rich. He spends his time sowing. A bottomless ditch. I will not grow rich. For money is sullen. And wisdom is sly. But youth is the pollen. That blows through the sky. And does not ask why. O wisdom and money. How can you requite the honey of honey that flies in that flight? The useless delight. So with his back against a tree, he stared at the pure golden feathers in the west until the sunset flowed into his heart like a slow wave of honey-dropping dew, murmuring from the other side of sleep. There was a fairy hush everywhere, even the setter at his feet. Lay there as if the twilight had bewitched. His russet paws into two russet leaves. A dog of russet leaves who did not stir a hair. Then something broke the peace. Like wind it was, the flutter of rising wind. But then it grew, until it was the rushing. Of winged stallions distant and terrible. Trampling beyond the sky. The hissing charge. Of lightless armies of angelic horse. Galloping down the stars. There were no words. In that implacable and feathery thunder. And yet there must have been, or Elliot's mind. Caught them like broken arrows out of the air. 13 sisters beside the sea. Have a care, my son. Build it a house called Liberty. And lock the doors with a stately key. None should enter it but the free. Have a care, my son. The walls are solid as Plymouth rock. Rock can crumble, my son. The door of seasoned New England stock. Before it, a Yankee fighting cock. Pecks redcoat kings away from the lock. Fighters can die, my son. The hearth is a corner where sages sit. Sages pass, my son. Washington's heart lies under it. And the long roof beams are chiseled and split. From hickory tough as Jackson's wit. Bones in the dust, my son. The trees in the garden are fair and fine. Trees blow down, my son. Connecticut elm and Georgia pine. The warehouse groans with cotton and swine. The cellar is full of scuppernong wine. Wine turns sour, my son. Surely a house so strong and bold. The wind is rising, my son. Will last till time is a pinch of mold. There is a ghost when the night is old. There is a ghost who walks in the cold. The trees are shaking, my son. The sisters sleep on Liberty's breast. the thunder thunders, my son. Like 13 swans in a single nest. But the ghost is naked and will not rest. Until the sun rise out of the west. The lightning lightens, my son. All night long like a moving stain. The trees are breaking, my son. The black ghost wanders his house of pain. There is blood where his hand has lain. It is wrong he should wear a chain. The sky is falling, my son. The warning beat at his mind like a bird and passed. Elliot roused. He thought, they are going south. He stared at the sky, confused. It was empty and bleak. But still he felt the shock of the hooves on his heart. The riderless horses never bridled or tamed. He heard them screaming like eagles loosed from a cloud. As they drove south to trample the indolent sun. And darkness set in his mind like a shadow enthroned. He could not read the riddle their flight had set. But he felt wretched and glad for the dog's cold nose. That now came nuzzling his hand. Who has set you free? Who has driven you out in the sky with an iron whip? Like blind old thunders stubbornly marching abreast. To carry a portent high on shoulders of stone. The length and breadth of the Union? The north and south are at peace and the east and west. The tomahawk is buried in prairie sod. The great frontier rolls westward with the sun. And the new states are crowding at the door. The buckskin states, the buffalo-horned, the wild. Mustangs with coats the color of crude gold. Their bodies, naked as the hunter's moon. Smell of new grass and the sweet milk of the corn. Defiant virgins, fiercely unpossessed. As the bird stars that walk the night untrodden. They drag their skies and sunsets after them. Like calico ponies on a rawhide rope. And who would ride them must have iron thighs. And a lean heart, bright as a bowie knife. Were they not fold with treasure in their eyes? Between the rattlesnake and the painted rock. Are they not matches for vaquero gods? Are they not occupation for the strength? Of a whole ruffian world of pioneers? And must they wait like spade mares in the rain? While Carolina and Connecticut fight an old quarrel out before a ghost. So Elliot talked to his young indignation, walking back home with the October moon. But even as he mused, he tried to picture the South, that languorous land where Uncle Tom's groaned biblically underneath the lash, and grinning Topsies mopped and mowed behind each honeysuckle vine. They called them niggers, and cut their ears off when they ran away. But then they loved their mammies, there was that. Although they sometimes sold them down the river. And when the niggers were not getting licked, or quoting scripture, they sang funny songs. By the Suwannee River, on the old plantation, the girls were always beautiful. The men wore varnished boots, raced horses, and played cards. And drank mint juleps till the time came round for fighting duels with their second cousins. Or tar and feathering some goddamn Yankee. The South, the honeysuckle, the hot sun. The taste of ripe persimmons and sugar cane. The cloyed and waxy sweetness of magnolias. White cotton blowing like a fallen cloud. And foxhounds belling the Virginia hills. And then the fugitive slave he'd seen in Boston. The black man with the eyes of a tortured horse. He whistled Ned. What do you think of it, Ned? We're abolitionists, I suppose, and father talks about Wendell Phillips and John Brown. But even so, that doesn't have to mean we'll break the Union up for abolition. And they can't want to break it up for slavery. It won't come to real fighting, will it, Ned? But Ned was busy with a rabbit track. There was the town, the yellow window of home. Meanwhile, in Concord, Emerson and Thoreau talked of an ideal state so purely framed. It never could exist. Meanwhile, in Boston, Minister Higginson and Dr. Howe waited for news about a certain project that had to do with Pike's and Harper's Ferry. Meanwhile, in Georgia, Clay Wingate dreamed. Settled more than 100 years. By the river and county of St. Xavier. The Wingate held their ancestry. as high as Taliaferro or huger. Maryland Carroll, Virginia Lee. They had ill-spelt letters of Albemarle's. And their first
grant ran. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.